barrier to these things. I want you to feel comfortable doing whatever you would like to do. So you'll find some colouring, you'll find some Play-Doh if you want to get really creative. You'll find some word searches. There are going to be things to listen to on the screen, there'll be things to watch. So as these things are happening, if it's easier for you to concentrate whilst doing something else, then feel free. If you'd prefer just to sit back and relax and enjoy, that's absolutely fine too. The pictures of creation that you'll see on the tables are going to be used later in the service, as are the plain pieces of paper, which we're going to use for the prayers. And anybody that's watching at home, you may want to grab yourself a picture that you can perhaps cut out of a magazine or a newspaper of some part of creation, and also an A5 piece of paper, any colour, any paper, and then you'll be able to join in with the prayers with us later on. So let's begin with some words from the book of Revelation. You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honour and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are able to come together this afternoon to worship you. Wherever we may be, you are with us, and we want to glorify you, hear your voice, and commit ourselves to living as you would wish us to live. Send your Holy Spirit amongst us now to guide us in our thoughts, words, and actions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm delighted that we've got Enid with us this afternoon, who's going to help lead us in our worship, and we're going to sing now of the wonder, power, and majesty of God as we join together in singing My Jesus, My Saviour, Lord, there is none like you. Thank you, Enid. we bring to God now our prayers of adoration and praise. Let us pray. Creator God, we come to you today deeply grateful for your creation. As we look around us, we are amazed at the greatness and majesty of all that you have made. Nature around us speaks of your greatness. The vast expanse of the sky, the mountains, trees, lakes, and streams speak of your great design. You have given us such beauty in the colours of the rainbow, the beauty of the flowers and fields. Words cannot adequately express the magnificence of all that you have created. We thank you that you have gifted us the warmth of the sun, the refreshing rain, the might of mountains, and the calm of the trickling stream. And we thank you that we are free to enjoy your creation, to walk in the woods, to feel sand between our toes, and to smell the wonderful fragrance of the many flowers and plants that decorate the places where we live. We are not worthy of all that you give, and we stand in awe of you. Almighty God, help us to appreciate all that you have created and to play our part in maintaining its beauty. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And we're going to continue our praise and adoration as we sing of the indescribable, uncontainable power of God. The words of this song reminding us of God's majesty being revealed through all creation. So we sing together from the highest of heights. Amazing creation, and now we come to him with our prayers of confession for the things that we have done that have contributed to damaging this wonderful world. Let us pray. God of the universe, we have worshipped, praised, and thanked you for all the amazing things you have created and given to us. We now come to say sorry and ask for your forgiveness. Forgive us for the times we have taken the earth's resources for granted and wasted what you have given to us. For when we have caused damage through our behaviour and the choices we make. for when we have neglected our duty to care for the world, and for when we have failed to act when others have shown disregard for creation. Transform our hearts and minds so that we would learn to care and share, to touch the earth with gentleness and love, respecting all living things. We thank you that you are a forgiving God and ask that you help us in our need to try harder to live up to your good and perfect will. We offer our prayers through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And we share together in the Lord's Prayer in whatever language or form you feel most comfortable. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Isn't it wonderful that we can come to God, say sorry, and know that we are forgiven? A sign of God's amazing love for each and every one of us. And we're going to reflect on that now as we sing again together. Over the mountains and the sea, I could sing of your love forever. Thank you. My apologies for getting the words in the wrong order on the screen there. I'm sure it will come as no surprise to you to know that this afternoon's reading is the story of creation from the book of Genesis, chapter 1. And we're going to hear and watch that reading now on the screen. Thank you.
In the beginning, God created the sky and the earth. The earth was empty and had no form. Darkness covered the ocean, and God's Spirit was moving over the water. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw that the light was good. So he divided the light from the darkness. God named the light day and the darkness night. Evening passed and morning came. This was the first day. Then God said, "Let there be something to divide the water in two." So God made the air to divide the water in two. Some of the water was above the air, and some of the water was below it. God named the air sky. Evening passed and morning came. This was the second day. Then God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered together so the dry land will appear." And it happened. God named the dry land earth. He named the water that was gathered together seas. God saw that this was good. Then God said, "Let the earth produce plants. Some plants will make rain for seeds. Others will make fruit with seeds in it. Every seed will produce more of its own kind of plant." And it happened. The earth produced plants. Some plants had grain for seeds. The trees made fruit with seeds in it. Each seed grew its own kind of plant. God saw that all this was good. Evening passed and morning came. This was the third day. Then God said, "Let there be lights in the sky to separate day from night. These lights will be used for signs, seasons, days, and years. They will be in the sky to give light to the earth." And it happened. So God made the two large lights. He made the brighter light to rule the day. He made the smaller light to rule the night. He also made the stars. God put all these in the sky to shine on the earth. They are to rule over the day and over the night. He put them there to separate the light from the darkness. God saw that all these things were good. Evening passed and morning came. This was the fourth day. Then God said, "Let the water be filled with living things, and let birds fly in the air above the earth." So God created the large sea animals. He created every living thing that moves in the sea. The sea is filled with these living things. Each one produces more of its own kind. God also made every bird that flies, and each bird produces more of its own kind. God blessed them and said, "Have many young ones and grow in number. Fill the water of the seas and let the birds grow in number on the earth." God saw that this was good. Evening passed and morning came. This was the fifth day. Then God said, "Let the earth be filled with animals, and let each produce more of its own kind. Let there be tame animals and small crawling animals and wild animals, and let each produce more of its kind." And it happened. So God made the wild animals, the tame animals, and all the small crawling animals to produce more of their own kind. God saw that this was good. Then God said, "Let us make human beings in our image and likeness, and let them rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky. Let them rule over the tame animals, over all the earth, and over all the small crawling animals on the earth." So God created human beings in his image. In the image of God, he created them. He created them male and female. God blessed them and said, "Have many children and grow in number. Fill the earth and be its master. Rule over the fish in the sea and over the birds in the sky. Rule over every living thing that moves on the earth." God said, "Look, I have given you all the plants that have grain for seeds, and I have given you all the trees whose fruits have seeds in them. They will be food for you. I have given all the green plants to all the animals to eat. They will be food for every wild animal, every bird of the air, and every small crawling animal." And it happened. God looked at everything he had made, and it was very good. Evening passed and morning came. This was the sixth day.
Amen. My thanks to Danny Coles for helping me with the technology to produce that for this afternoon. I don't know about you, but I absolutely love creation and nature, but it absolutely blows my mind. Whether you kind of sit in the camp where you believe that creation took place in literally 6 days or six periods of time, whether you're more comfortable with the Big Bang theory or the theory of evolution, I don't think that there is any doubting that creation and the complexity of living things is utterly amazing. And for me, it's just one of the things that convinces me of the existence of God. I simply cannot comprehend how mighty oak trees can grow from tiny acorns, or how a tiny, helpless baby can grow into a fully functioning human being without it being as a result of some supernatural being. You can try and blind me with the science, but I still maintain that the existence of God is the only explanation that rings true for me. But as I said at the beginning, what I really wanted to think about today is where we fit into the world. What was God's intention when he created the world, everything in it, and ended up making men and women? I think the simple answer is love. God did not need to create the universe. He chose to create it. And God is a God of love. And love is best expressed towards something or someone. So God created the world and people as an expression of his love. I wonder how we respond to that. God creates the world, and as we heard in the reading, after each part of the creation process, God declares it to be good. I wonder, as God looks at his creation now, how much of it he would still say is good. I think sometimes he must be quite disappointed when he sees the damage that has been done and is continuing to be done to his wonderful world. It's clear from many parts of the Bible that God has placed us in the world to be stewards or tenants and to look after all other living things. God has ultimate rule and authority over the universe, but he delegates some of his authority to the human race, and he expects us to take responsibility for the environment and the other creatures that share the planet with us. If Dave wouldn't mind just clicking onto the next screen for me, that would be fabulous. Thank you. There's just a small number of quotes on the screen from the Bible that illustrate the point that the earth is not ours, it belongs to God, and it remains God's. The bit in Leviticus I really like. We are but aliens and tenants. I quite like the tenants bit. I'm not sure I want to be referred to as an alien, but, you know, that's fine. I don't know if you ever rented a property, but when I was a student, I was a tenant. I had to pay a bond at the beginning of the year, which would be returned to me at the end of my tenancy, as long as the house was still in good condition. Well, in as good condition as it was when I moved in. It was student accommodation, after all. And when you rent a property, you are expected to look after it, aren't you? It doesn't belong to you. When you leave, the landlord will expect the property to be in the same condition that it was when you moved in, perhaps give or take a little bit of wear and tear. So if we are tenants of God's creation, then surely we should be striving to ensure that we maintain it to the same standard as it was given to us, and ensure that when we leave it, it is still in that good condition. I'm sure many of us are well aware of the concepts of global warming and climate change. We may get bored of hearing about it. We may have differing views on what we think about it. But over the past few years, it has become increasingly clear that our behaviour as human beings is having a significant impact on the world. And the damage we are causing is having a knock-on effect on the lives of all of us. As stewards of God's creation, I believe we have a responsibility to address these issues and to look at what we can do as individuals, families, churches, and communities to play our part in stopping the damage and seeking to care for creation as God intended. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm absolutely no expert on matters of climate change. I'm as guilty as the next person for driving my diesel car and for, you know, throwing things away when they perhaps don't need to be thrown away. And I was immediately struck when I was thinking of today of a friend of mine who is, for as long as I've known him, has been passionate about all things to do with the environment. And I was hoping to invite him along this afternoon to chat to us about these issues, but unfortunately he couldn't make it. However, with the joy of technology and Dave's wonderful skill, Paul was able to join me here last week and we recorded a conversation together. Now, I'll be honest with you, Paul and I could have talked for hours. And actually, we ended up with about half an hour of conversation that Dave recorded for us. I'm not going to expect you to sit through the whole half an hour this afternoon. But I'm going to share about 10 minutes of that conversation with you now to help us in our thinking about what we might be able to do next. Thank you, Dave. So I just wonder then, Paul, when did you kind of first become involved in environmental type issues and what was it that sparked that interest for you?
Yeah. When I was a teenager, I was involved in the peace movement in CND and things like that.
Okay.
And that carried on into my 20s and while I was a student, lots of different actions and activism around that. I went to live eventually in Doncaster. My family moved to Doncaster. And a thing happened there whereby an incinerator company, at that time called Lee Environmental, it's had various names along the way, decided that they wanted to develop an incinerator in Doncaster at Kirk Sandall. And this led to a huge campaign that I was involved in to stop them building this incinerator. There was a public inquiry, there was lots of activity around that, lots of campaigning and research and things like that. And that was really my sort of first involvement in any kind of environmental campaigning. But when I came to Mansfield, I got involved. I had children, so I didn't have as much time with young children. But I did get involved in Friends of the Earth. And we ran a number of campaigns. There was a thing which people in the area might remember called RAPID, which was a campaign against the Pennymint Farm development, where they wanted to cover over the fields. And these fields are like overwintering sites. And well, they're sites that are used by birds, lots of different species of birds. So again, that was an interesting campaign. Mm. I've been involved in lots of campaigning, but it started with the anti-incinerator thing in Doncaster and then has developed from there onto protecting different wildlife sites and campaigning on fracking and then onto climate change issues. It's gradually developed.
I guess the kind of the success, as you describe it, of your campaign must have given you the motivation to keep going as well, because I guess if you see something that works, you sort of feel like if you've had an impact, you can do that again. That's really interesting. I think there's kind of a tendency sometimes to think issues around global warming and climate change only affect other countries. Mm-hmm. So we kind of, you know, we're okay, we don't really need to worry, and we can see it on the news and we can pray about it and then we can sort of switch it off and not really think. But is that true, or are we more affected in the UK than perhaps we realise, and even in Mansfield and in this area?
I think it affects us both directly and indirectly. So we're already starting to see around the world, including in Britain, the effects of climate change. The climate's warming. We're getting more records broken in terms of rainfall, in terms of heat, all around the world, and Europe and Britain included. Fortunately for us in this area, we're not too prone in most parts of this part of the world to flooding, but other parts of Britain, for example, are having, you know, large-scale flooding on a regular basis now because of the increase in precipitation, which is what was predicted with climate change, that Britain, you know, we will get warmer, but the chief result here will be we will have, you know, huge amounts of rainfall at certain times of the year all at once. And when the climate warms up, basically that means more energy is being put into the environment, into the atmosphere. More energy means more dramatic weather. And that was one of the reasons why, you know, the whole global conversation around climate change changed the wording where people were talking about global warming, because some people were seeing global warming as a good thing. Oh, we'd be growing grapevines in Kent and, you know, marvellous. It's not just about the whole world heating up. It's about the knock-on effects of that.
Obviously, one of the things we're looking at today is kind of how we believe as Christians, we're stewards, if you like, of God's creation, and we're just tenants in the world.
Yes.
So as a Christian yourself, does your faith have any impact on your kind of views around the environmental issues? Do the two go hand in hand? Do you ever find any conflicts there? How does that work for you?
It is an inspiration, and there are lots of inspiring writers and thinkers in the Christian tradition, from the Old Testament and the Gospels, through to people like St. Francis of Assisi, Hildegard of Bingen, Meister Eckhart, all these people. You can look at, particularly in the mystical tradition of Christianity, there's a lot of environmental awareness and feeling for nature in there, and you know, that's an inspiration. And also the justice aspect in I think it's Micah, where it talks about, what does the Lord require of you but to do justly? And it's about environmental and social justice. Mm. You know, we in the West have had kind of, not all of us, because obviously there's inequality in the West as well, but a lot of people in the West have had a very high standard of living, whereas not only have people been denied that historically in other parts of the world, but they're going to be denied it in the future if things continue to worsen in terms of the climate. Mm. So there's justice, there's the inspiration of the thinkers. There are issues around the kind of some of the language, particularly in translation of the Bible, where people take things like dominion, and that's mastership, and you have the right to command things, whereas I prefer the word you use, custodianship, that we, you know, you are there to help and assist and guard rather than to take control and exploit everything. I think exploitation is the thing that we're fighting against, and that, you know, that is a, it can be problematic depending on the translation, how people see aspects of the Bible. You can see how certain fundamentalist sects can use it to mean something totally different, you know, and say that, oh no, it's, you know, you're anti-biblical if you're saying we've got to live in harmony because we should have dominion and control everything and be in charge, which I don't see it that way.
As part of this afternoon, as well, I want to try and encourage the people here to make a bit of a pledge, to make maybe a small change or to take one small action that might help to reverse some of the damage or slow down some of the damage that we're doing to the planet. I just wonder, I mean, you talked about your kind of experiences with campaigning. They sound quite big things and quite successful. But do our small things, you talked about perhaps reducing our meat consumption, but can, you know, small things like switching off lights that we're encouraged to do and turning up, do they really make a difference? If enough of us do it, does it make a difference? Is it worth doing?
There's two answers to that. One is not on its own, but two is yes. So yeah, we can make a difference. We can change things in our own lives, and that means perhaps changing things for our family, and that perhaps means changing things for our extended family and our community. So it expands out from you as an individual. Just small actions that you're taking influence other people, and hopefully that has a spread.
There, and I'm mindful that the COP26 climate conference is coming up. And again, you know, we can sign petitions, we can write to our MPs or whatever. Mm-hmm. I'm seeing quite a lot of stuff, particularly from Christian Aid, around kind of taking action around the COP26 conference. And again, do you think as individuals or as a body of Christians, we can have any influence over those world leaders in terms of kind of pushing them to look at these issues?
I think we can. I think we need to counterbalance the other interests. When you think of politicians, they've got various interests vying for their attention and trying to cause them to act in certain ways. So I think it's our duty to try and counterbalance some of the other influences. Obviously, big finance and the fossil fuel industry will be trying to, squeeze out the last drops of profit they can from their industry before it has to change. So I think it's, you know, it's our duty to try and have some effect upon them. But as I say, we can try and have political pressure, but I think the social change and change within society is as important, if not more, because from my own experience of politics, it is more difficult to change things if society is not changed in that direction anyway. It's a lot easier if society is already acting in a certain way and trying to do things.
So well, Paul, it's been absolutely fascinating to chat to you. Thank you so much for your insights and for all that you've shared with us. And I hope people have been very inspired by what you've said. So thank you very
much. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If you're interested in hearing the complete conversation with Paul, it is going to be available in full on the Circuit YouTube channel after the service. I know I'm biased, but I do think it's worth a listen if you get a chance. And Paul talks a little bit more about the things that he identifies as being the main problems at the moment, contributing to global warming and to climate change, and how we can perhaps address some of those. I realise you've only just seen that and you're probably still taking stuff in, but if there is anything that anybody wanted to share that strikes them about the topic or about the conversation you've just listened to, it would be lovely to hear any views. I really liked what Paul says about justice when he refers to Micah and he talks about social and environmental justice. And I think, you know, we can get hung up on the kind of issues of climate change and global warming as being an environmental thing, but actually it is about as much about how much we show our love for our neighbours, isn't it, and how this is impacting people across the globe. And we know our neighbours aren't just the people that live in our immediate vicinity, but our neighbours around the world. And some of this is about considering the needs of those across the globe as well. It's all well and good raising our awareness of these issues, but as I said to Paul, it can be too easy, can't it, to watch the news, say a prayer, and then move on to something else. And the only way I think we can act as true stewards of God's creation and to respond to his desire for us to look after the world is to actually take some action. And I'm going to spend a few minutes now, I'd like us to spend a few minutes just reflecting on things that we've heard and shared and make a pledge. As I said to Paul, I'm going to ask you to make a pledge. Don't panic, I'm not asking you to do anything radical. You don't need to become vegan for me, it's fine. Just to do one thing that will perhaps make a difference to the environmental issues we face. It doesn't have to be huge, life-changing commitment. One small thing on its own may not feel like it's going to make a difference, but if several people take those small steps, then it will have an impact. And again, I was really struck by what Paul said about the influence that we can have on those people around us. So one small thing that you do might cause somebody at home or somebody in your family or somebody of your neighbours to ask why you're doing that, and they might consider doing the same, and it can spread. So maybe you could pledge to explore something around renewable energy. Maybe you could reduce your meat consumption. One of the parts of the interview that I didn't share with you there, but is in the full conversation, was Paul's conversation around farming and how it contributes greatly to the greenhouse gases. Now, that's not to say that we don't want people to still have livelihoods in farming at all, but it's about managing that. It's about the kind of, if we reduce our meat consumption, it reduces the amount of farming, it reduces the amount of greenhouse gases. So that's one thing we can look at. We can look at reducing our use of single-use plastics or pledge to reuse something that we were going to throw away. Maybe you consider how you make your journeys this week, and can you reduce one of those car journeys that you take? In the conversation, you may have picked up that I mentioned COP26. I don't know, you may have heard about it on the news. There's quite a lot out there at the moment. It's the United Nations Climate Change Conference that is starting next week in Glasgow. The world leaders will be coming together to discuss how they can work together to achieve targets set for countries in relation to climate change. So maybe an email to your MP, encouraging them to raise issues in Parliament to make sure that these kind of issues are raised and are addressed. On the table is in front of you, and if you're at home, hopefully you've managed to grab yourself a picture that represents creation. You'll see lots of pictures of creation that I've cut out of magazines. Just take one that you are attracted to. It doesn't matter what it is, a picture that you quite like the look of. And I'd like you just to think about that and take a pen and think about one thing that you perhaps can commit to doing in the coming weeks and months that will help you in your role as stewards of God's creation. Now, we're going to play a song while we do this, and I'm going to invite you to write your pledge across the picture. I'll be honest with you, normally, when I do things like this, I'll say to you, this is between you and God. You don't need to share it. It's absolutely fine. Today, however, I'm going to say, why not have a conversation with somebody next to you about this? Because actually, in my experience, if we say we're going to do something and nobody knows, we might not do it. It's too easy to kind of go, do you know what, I'll say I'll do it, but something else has come up. I've forgotten. Time's moved on. If we share it with somebody else, we are far more likely to stick to what we've said we're going to do. And we can support each other and help each other in our attempts to make a change. It's not about checking up on people. It's not about going, did you do what you said you were going to do? It's simply about, how are you getting on? And if they say to you, do you know what, I can't do it, it's just too hard. Okay, well, have you thought about doing something else? Or have you thought about this? Or I tried this and this really worked for me. Why don't you give it a go? So, we're going to play a song. If you're watching at home, you're going to hear the song, you're going to see the song as well. But please feel free to comment on YouTube or Facebook and share with others what you're going to try and do as well. Have a conversation with the people sat next to you. Share your ideas, offer your suggestions, and commit to something that you are going to try and do in the next few weeks. Now, I asked Paul if he'd got a favourite hymn or a song that we could use in the service, and he chose For the Beauty of the Earth, which is a great reminder of all the things that we praise God for in his creation. So I've chosen the John Rutter version for us to listen to as we reflect, as we pledge, and as we share what we're going to try to do. I got so engrossed in our conversation there. Sorry, I lost track of the time and the song finishing. I hope you've found that useful to have those conversations. I will share with you what I've written down, although I'm hoping my family aren't watching at home, because I'm going to pledge to try for us to have, I'm imposing on them as well because I do the shopping and do the cooking, one meat-free day per week. Now, this will be interesting when I live in a family of very fussy eaters, well, fussy children, one of whom wouldn't quite happy not eat meat, one of whom will only eat it if it looks like chicken nuggets. But we're going to give it a go. So if anybody's got any good recipes that fussy children will eat that don't involve meat, then I'm all up for that. And we'll see how that goes. And I also have put that I'm going to try litter picking because I did ask for a litter picker for my birthday in March with all good intentions of when I walked around the estate picking up litter. And I did it while I was doing a walking challenge and was walking every day. And since I've stopped walking every day, I haven't been out litter picking. So I'm going to get my litter picker out the boot of the car once a week and have a little walk around the estate and pick up litter. So next time you see me, see how I'm getting on. I may not manage both of them, but I will try. My kids might have refused to do the meat-free day, but I will try and do it. Oh, sorry. And we'll see how we get on. So I hope it's given you some time to reflect and think. And I invite you to take your pledge away with you. Please don't leave it on the table. Take it. Put it somewhere prominent. Use it as a bookmark or pop it on your fridge. And when you see each other, ask how you're getting along and encourage each other. We're going to come to a time of prayer. And for the prayers of intercession today, you are going to need one of the pieces of coloured paper on the table each and a pen. And we're going to think about something that you would like to pray for in relation to the theme of creation and climate change. Again, if you're watching at home, hopefully you've had a chance to grab yourself an A5 piece of paper and you can join in. I'm going to offer some prayers, and you may wish to jot down some words or phrases from the prayers that I speak. You may have your own prayer that you wish to write on the piece of paper. Christian Aid are currently doing a campaign entitled Rise to the Moment. It's a journey of prayer and action in the run-up to the COP26 conference. It says on their website about the campaign that we are the climate crisis is a storm we all face, but we are not all in the same boat. And they're encouraging people to make prayer boats, which is what we're going to do this afternoon, and to share pictures of their prayer boats on the internet to raise awareness of climate justice. Don't panic, you're not going to have to do that. I will do all of that before you. I just need you to make the boats, but I will make it very clear how we're going to do it. They're actually doing a special installation of prayer boats at the conference. We're too late, sadly, to send ours, but we're not too late to pop a photo on our social media pages and to help raise awareness locally. So when we've offered our prayers and you've written your prayers on your piece of paper, we will hopefully each make a boat that we can then create a display with. So we're going to pray. Feel free to write your own prayers down while I'm praying, as I say, and I'll talk you through the boat bit afterwards. So let us pray. Father, we pray for world leaders, especially during COP26. We ask that you grant them wisdom as they work to lay out concrete plans to reach targets set out in the Paris Agreement. We pray for any country not able to attend in person due to COVID restrictions. We ask that this doesn't detract from their ability to participate, and we pray that technology will run smoothly. Loving Lord, we pray that you will place on the hearts of every leader those who are most vulnerable to climate change. Lord God, our hearts break at the devastating impact the climate crisis is already having on those living in extreme poverty. We pray that this injustice will not be ignored, that more will be done to protect those most vulnerable around the world, not just those in their own country. Loving Lord, your word reminds us how much you value and love children. We pray for the devastating impact that the climate crisis is having on children's lives. We thank you for young people and their passion and conviction to care for and protect your world. We pray that their actions and words will be taken seriously. We ask that as adults we will strive to protect the world that they will grow up in. God of justice, we pray for fairness during the talks. Lord, we know that those who are worst hit by the climate crisis are those who have done the least to contribute to it and have the fewest resources to implement change. We pray for radical justice and for fairness in the decisions made at COP26. And we pray that those decisions won't be empty words. We ask that those in positions of power will be held accountable to the targets that have been set, and they will work with conviction to not only achieve these, but to go beyond them. We ask that momentum is not lost after the talks have finished. Heavenly Father, stir our hearts into action. Inspire us with ways we can make a difference in our homes, communities, and the world around us. We pray for your prompting where we can do more to love our neighbour. We offer all of our prayers in the name of Jesus. Amen. So hopefully you now have a piece of paper with a prayer on it or some words, and we are going to turn them into boats. Here we go. It's a bit like a Blue Peter moment now. Follow my instructions and we should all be fine. So if you take your piece of paper and hold it this way, and then fold it in half, so lengthways. I'll have to keep putting mine down to do it. So fold it long ways like that. Okay. Don't worry if you've done it the other way, because we're going to do that in a minute as well. But start off with that way. And then open it up again. You've got your crease. And fold it the other way and leave it folded this time. So now you've got your piece of paper, folded edge at the top, and you can see the crease that you made initially down the middle. Okay? Are we all with me? Okay, so now from your top corner, you're going to fold it down into the middle, so to make like a triangle in the middle. So if you fold that corner down into the middle, it won't go all the way down to the bottom. That's fine, it's not supposed to, like that. And the same on the other side. If this works, it will be a miracle. But we have faith. So it should look something like that. Two flappy bits that are folded down and a little bit along the bottom. So you're all right if you're watching at home, or if you go home later, you can watch it again on YouTube and pause it and rewind it. We're doing it live. So we're there. We've got to the point where we've got two flappy bits and a bit at the bottom. Yeah? That's it. So you fold the whole thing down so you've got the triangle bit at the bottom. Excellent. So at the bottom, you should have your straight rectangular edge, and there should be two bits there. So if you take the front bit, just the first fold, and fold it upwards so that it goes along the bottom of the triangle like that, that's just folded up from the bottom. Yes, looking good so far. Looking good. If anybody gets lost, you can always see me afterwards and we'll do it at a slower pace. And then if you flip it over, you'll see these little bits here over the edge. They just need to be tucked down over the top, so you've got a neat little triangle again at the top. There, so you get that shape. And you should still have a little bit down here that you can then fold up over the top of those triangles that you've pushed down. And we end up with the same kind of shape, but without the flat bit at the bottom. So that's just folded up. Okay. Are we there? Have we got something that looks a bit like a triangle with a flappy bit up here? Marilyn's looking good. You're good at following instructions. I'm impressed. Okay, now... tricky bit. Get your thumbs in the bit underneath to make it look, it looks a bit like a hat look. And if you just slowly open it, you should be able to push it together from the sides and you end up with a square shape. And fold all your creases down so it makes a nice tight square. Let me show that again. So we were there and we just squidge it together to make a square. But thumbs underneath. That's it, that's it, that's it. Push it together gently, gently, and it should go. That's it. Keep going, and you get like a square shape. And then push it down. Yeah? Brilliant. Okay, have it with you. Open bit at the bottom, and you point at the top. And then take one layer of the bottom bit and fold it up to the top bit like that to create a triangle. I know this sounded good in my head at home. It worked when I did it on my own. I'm not going to make a blue Peter presenter, it's fine. So we fold that one up and the same on the other side, so you'll end up with a triangle that looks a bit like that. So we were at the point of a square with the folded bit at the bottom. We should have had an open bit at the bottom, sorry, the pointed bit at the top, open bit at the bottom, fold one up, fold the other up. Yeah? So it's like a little bit like we had before, where you can get your thumbs underneath the bottom again. It's gone like a smaller version of what we had before, a smaller hat. And we're going to do exactly the same thing. So with your thumbs underneath, you're going to gently pull it out and flatten it down to make that square shape again. I'll help you afterwards, it's fine. We're going to be good. We're going to get the boats if it's the last thing I do before I leave. We're doing well. We're nearly there. We're almost there. So if we've got a square. Oh, it helps if I know my shapes, doesn't it, really? How have we got a square that looks a bit like that? Now, you should, if it's worked, be able to take the top little bits and pull them very gently down like that and create a boat. So from there... from the square at the top, there should be two little bits at the top that will flip it the other way up if it doesn't quite work. Leslie's got it. And we have a boat shape. Unfortunately, I haven't worked out how to do it in reverse, so I can't go back a step until if you're struggling. Find the bits that open, Robert, at the top, and they should try flipping it over. Do the triangle bits pull down? Oh, might have to come back to you in a little while. If we've managed to get a boat, fabulous, pop it in front of you. If you haven't, don't worry, we can do them afterwards. We have a boat there. Amazing, Colin, well done. Marilyn, you were doing so well. What happened? Look, this is one I made earlier. This is what it should look like. You were all doing so well. It's fine, it's not a problem. What we'll do, we're going to sing our final hymn, and what I was going to do is come round and collect your boats and create a display. But what I might do is come round and try and help people that have almost got there to create a boat, and we'll make the display after the service and take a photograph, because it's not a problem. We're going to create boats if it's the last thing I do, as I say. So, as I leave you with your origami boats, our final hymn reminds us of how great God's faithfulness is. No matter what is going on in the world, through every season. In all nature, God is faithful and provides all that we need. And we're going to join together in singing the great hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Thank you, Enid. For anybody who hasn't still managed to do their boat, please feel free to see me afterwards and we will create one together. I will not let you leave without having done a boat. Creator God, as we leave this place, may we be filled with your Holy Spirit, inspired into action and determined to make your world a better place for all in your kingdom, both for now and in the years to come. Let us share the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.